Aloha piha. My name is Michael Kumukauoha Lee. I'm a native Hawaiian cultural practitioner. I am a papakilohoku, which is a Hawaiian star priest. We're in front of the BLNR boardroom at the Kalani Moku building, and we're here to testify against the Board of Land and Natural Resources having rules to limit public access to Mauna Kea. And as a papakilohoku, a star priest, the interesting, strange thing about Section C2 of the agenda for today is they're limiting all access nighttime to Mauna Kea, which as a star priest, I have to see the stars and they only come out at night. So they are infringing on my federal constitutional rights under Section Article 1 of the Constitution to practice my belief system. And I need the pu'us at night, and that's called the cultural landscape. And I also need their alignments to the stars that come up, and I'll be restricted under this emergency rule, which is basically to limit the access of Hawaiians and Hawaiian cultural practitioners for the TMT telescope. And I bring today, the city council gave me an honorary certificate as a papakilohoku, recognizing my teaching that I do throughout the community and what I do with the papakilohoku information to protect Hawaiian cultural resources, and that I teach up at Imiloa, the stars, to the TMT astronomers and the Subaru astronomers and the general public on all islands, Molokai, at Kiawenui Fish Pond, at Honoka'a on the Big Island, at Puna on the Big Island, at Kailuakona on the Big Island, Waianae O'ahu, and on Maui at Ho'onaula. And that I also, for the issue on the Big Island dealing with Mauna Kea, I bring my family royal patents of our land in Ka'apahu, which is in the Ahupua'a of Hamakua, which is the district of Mauna Kea. And we bring our wills that we still own that 353 acres of half of Ahupua'a. And we also bring our being recognized in federal district court for the Big Island in the case between Kahea versus the U.S. Federal Fisheries Service. So with my teaching, with my family lands in Hamakua, with my recognized standing in federal court, we come to do a contested case, which is to say the rule that they're presenting is illegal. And we intend to do a contested case, which is goes to a contested case hearing to put what they call a finding of fact, our documents on the table, to prove what we say is true and accurate. And continuing with this, it goes to the secular state government, starting with Governor Ige, making the claim that Mauna Kea is special, and that word special has a different connotation than Kanaka Maole sacred, because special means it's not of the norm or the usual. Sacred means it's connected to the divine. Anything connected to the divine cannot be trampled on. We call it kapu, or stay away. And if you were to put a telescope on the Wailing Wall in Jerusalem, you would have a war with the Jews. If you went to Mecca, and where they go around the meteorite during the Hajj, they would have a holy war on you. If you were to put the TMT on Mount Fuji, a sacred mountain to the Shinto religion in Japan, that would cause another war with Japan. And yet they try to make an equivalence of taking away the sacred and putting the secular. So this battle in the secular world of management and management of resources is abhorrent to the Hawaiian cultural practitioner and the sensibility of all Hawaiians, because the root of Hawaiian genealogy, all Hawaiians, is to the divine. It goes back to Papa and Wakea, Earth Mother and Sky Father, the first Mo'is of Hawaii. And how can you make a distinction between secular with Papa and Wakea. So when we advance this, and Papa was born on Mauna Kea, so when we advance this idea, you can't do anything that you choose to do without respect and recognition of the religious, cultural value sets of the Hawaiian people, i.e. this battle is a spiritual, not a religious, but a spiritual battle between what is pono, and the definition of pono is what fits perfectly together under the elemental principles of what is true. So as we advance this idea, a simple stone or rock on Mauna Kea for the non-practitioner, non-kanakamaole is a rock and a stone is a stone. But for us, our genealogy takes us back to the divine and the connectivity that all our ancestors, be it the shark, be it Lilinoi, the mist, be it Poliahu, the snow goddess, be it Tutupele, the lava flow, be it Kamapua'a, the earthquake moving force that shakes the land, or the mano in the ocean, or the pueo that flies. All of these aumakuas or sacred divine beings are part of our genealogy. It's part of our identity of who we are and where our place is in Hawaii, which is spiritual, a spiritual kingdom, not a secular kingdom. So when we see all the young people coming up from the charter schools to make their feelings prominent of where they stand, they're looking for spiritual guidance and leadership, and they're standing up for their spiritual na'au. This has nothing to do with money or property or royal patents. This is to do with their family kuleana. The stone can be impregnated, what we call akua noho. Akua, the divine, noho, where you live. If the divine chooses, whether the Western world sees it as possession, and they, in the religious context, may see it as a demon spirit or a divine spirit or an extraterrestrial alien spirit from beyond us. The fact of the matter is our history, our mo'olelo, our genealogies are impregnated with the divine. And look at all of our chants, kualii, hiakapolio pele, kamapua'a, kavelo, all of them talk about the divine in nature. That is part of what it means to be Kanaka Maole, or the indigenous people of this land. And they know when the secular is trying to wordsmith the kapu or the sacred out of what is religious, what not religious, but what is spiritual. So as we move forward in this fight, and it is a fight and it is a battle, more than just over wordsmithing and words, it's the battle for truth. Through truth, we gain understanding. And through that understanding, you know where your kuleana or responsibility lies for all the different clans and genealogies that are culturally Hawaiian. And what the benefit is, it goes to our Hawaiian konohiki system, is you do not collapse the source. The source that produces the increase of abundance and opportunities for a comfortable life without collapsing nature, without causing erosion, without destroying the people through unintended consequences of not having the knowledge to see what the long-term consequences are, and identifying the protective mechanisms that are set up through nature and through what is real of how our natural system works. And so this battle that is being fought is a battle of truth, because we're all in the same web of responsibility. If you do it wrong, you will see the benefits that come out of making wrong decisions. It becomes the land of disorder because it doesn't fit. And the reason why it doesn't fit, because what they've based the foundation, which leads to the form of what you're doing, is not pono. It doesn't fit right. It doesn't benefit. It collapses the center, and that causes great angst and chaos. So it's understanding the basic principles of truth that are going on here. And of course, the secular system is at odds with spirituality and the truth. It wants to define the truth as it sees it for its selfish, greedy ends and its selfish, greedy desires. To build something where you're not supposed to build something, either because there's a traditional seasonal wind that will tear down what you have, and people coming to say, I know better than the traditional patterns that are available for us to work within a certain parameter. Our struggle again with how we are to move forward is basically to teach so people can understand these elemental truths that were passed on in generational knowledge. And they are truths that do exist. And so it's opening up the treasure box, because in the Kanaka Maoli philosophy is that you don't bring out your ancestors' bones in the sun, which means you don't reveal the hidden aqueducts of truth that your families have learned as survival strategies in spirituality. But today we find with the laws in this secular state that if you don't put it on the table, guess what? They don't get protected. Hidden treasures get pulverized, whether it be our Ivi Kupuna, whether it be petroglyphs in caves, springs that go to the ocean that make the limu grow, that are the foundation food source for our fisheries, or how the mating habits of the fish have to take place, like salmon are endemic fish in fresh water, and the state is closing down for years all the streams that are not perennial or seasonal. And the reason why our fisheries haven't collapsed is the underground lava pohoihoi tubes, or karst, K-A-R-S-T, caves of calcium carbonate ancient reefs are feeding fresh water to places. But we see all over the state the drop in limu, the drop in fish. They blame it on the fishermen, but they're at the root cause of destroying the food for the fish, which is the limu, and the reproduction cycles of the fish, which are like salmon, which most people have no clue about. And unless we educate the lawmakers and the community at large, this will be a desert island both on and in the fisheries as well. So this advancement of the knowledge of elemental truths and basic principles of knowledge of how increase in opportunity of abundance, Mauna Kea, the big breadbasket for the ocean and for the land, because it controls the weather patterns around us. When you have our endemic trees that capture the mist from the pounding waves, are taken up to the mountain, start to condense in the cold air, and are put into the ground, and then start a secondary water cycle rain at about 1 o'clock, 1:30 in the afternoon. And most of our endemic trees, sandalwood, our likulehua, our koa, have all been deforested. So Hawaii has become a desert because we produce our own rain vis-a-vis the ocean. Chant one, kumulipo, the mountains protect the sea, and vice versa, the sea protects the mountain by sending its ocean mist to the mountain to have the water cycle make sure our streams and underground streams, kumulipo chant one, the surface stream is the Wahine, the broad stream, the narrow stream is the male, the underground subterranean rivers and lakes that also feed the ocean with nutrients, not nitrates, but nutrients that make algae we call limo proliferate, that increase the opportunity of abundance for fish to sustain themselves through food and through the food chain cycle of the ocean, because that's where the big protein food source is. So that's a glimpse of an elemental principle of truth. This is called the Naulu rains and the Naulu mists, and it happens on all islands. You can actually, without rain, just the mist from the ocean and the condensation in dew, make an entire mountainside in Waianae green and productive, because in that mist is zooplankton and phytoplankton. It already has its fertilizer besides the white life-giving waters. So as we move through these cycles, we have to teach, we have to educate our people, those people who are from outside of Hawaii, when they're talking about laws and rules and regulations of what is a define a Hawaiian cultural resource. These are Hawaiian cultural resources, basic principles of elemental truths that they have not been taught, they don't understand, but are the pillars of the increase of opportunity of abundance without collapsing the source. In the mainland, what do? They have a 10-story building with millions of chickens in an Auschwitz-like environment that produces eggs that are yellow, not orange, runny, and not stable because the animal is so stressed. You are what you eat. If you live in a hellish condition, your produce of eggs are going to be hellish and disease. When they do their salmon farms, over the last 35 years, they have collapsed all the fisheries, and then they try to do GMO, genetically modified salmon, and that is to grow fast, but after a few generations, they become unfertile, and if they escape, they'll collapse the natural salmon populations. So as we say this, coming behind us is our Aloha Aina group, and they will take it from here. So I thank you for your attention. Mahalo nui.
Mama Kakaua,
Mama Kakaua.
Aloha mai kako, la hui Hawaii, o Kaukaohu Kalani Wahilani, here Kalani Moku building, to stand for our lahui and to the DLNR with the new rules that they're implementing or they're trying to implement. But we're just here to stand together with our lahui, and just want to share. It's exciting times for our people. You know, we have been, I guess you can say, emancipated. You know, got freed, and we've been oppressed for a long time, people, 122 years, even more. You know, but to find the truth, you know, there's no treaty of annexation. It failed twice. We are illegally occupied in this fake state of Hawaii. And, you know, 20 years ago when I heard that, I was like, from my sister Kilikina and brother Digi Kamana, I used to think they were crazy. But now I'm with them, you know, because the truth has set me free. And we're here to stand for our lahui, to stand for our nakupuna, to stand for our queen, to stand for our mo'opuna who are still coming. You know, our nation, the Hawaiian kingdom was once, and it still is in existence, but it's so beautiful. We have a lot to do, but we're here to do the work. And it's mahalo, Oren, and just want to mahalo our kupuna who stood in the gap for us, who continue to stand for us. Our queen, Kawikeaoli, Kamehameha III. He did a lot for our lahui. And it makes me sad finding the truth, but in a sense, I'm excited. These are exciting times for our lahui, and we have to come together. Olokahi, holomua yaoko. We go forward, you know, and when we rise, we are rising. And we shall be like a wave that nothing can resist us, you know. So we just have to kuha'ahel kupono, yes. Aloha aina, kapu aloha. We just give reverence where reverence is due to our kupuna, our nakupuna, our na'aumakua, our mo'i wahine. And we love all. Mahalo nui, mahalo nui.
Aloha. Aloha. I just wanted to say that I'm very proud to be standing side by side with everybody today. And I just want to let everyone know that even those that couldn't make it today, that I know you guys are all here. And you guys are where, you know, you guys are at work, or if you guys are at home taking care of business, like, you guys would be here. And we love you guys. And we just want everybody to know that we hope that we can make some sense to them in the building when we get to our meeting and we have our testimonies. I hope that everybody's voices will be heard, like really heard, because they need to listen to what the people have to say. And so thank you. Aloha.
Oh, my. Thank you. Hey, aloha mai, Hawaii. I'm Hanalei Fergustrom from Mokuokiawi. I'm the spokesperson for Nakapuna Mokuokiawi, and I'm here at the land board meeting to discuss agenda item C1 and C2, which is an attempt by the state to curtail the movements of Hawaiians and the religious practices on Mauna Kea. And so I sent this testimony, and I'm going to share this at the meeting, but we only have 3 minutes, so I want to be able to share it, because I probably won't be saying this inside the room, but it's very important to understand. Okay, so it says, we stand firmly against the proposed use of emergency rulemaking procedures to adopt a new section on the Hawaii Revised Hawaii Administrative Rules as Title 13, Chapter 123, Section 21-2, to restrict use of and access to portions of the hunting areas, Units A and K, Mauna Kea, Hawaii Island, to protect against imminent peril to public safety and natural resources. This is what the thing is about. So, in my testimony, I put it this way. Number one, there's no evidence of imminent peril to public safety and natural resources that was not caused by the aggressive behavior of law enforcement agencies against the peaceful protectors exercising their constitutionally protected rights of free speech and the religious freedom enumerated in the First Amendment of the United States Constitution. Other protections include, but not limited to, Public Law 95-341, which is the Native American Religious Freedom Act, Public 103-150, which is the Ecology Bill, which clearly states that the Hawaiian people never directly relinquish their inherent sovereignty or their national lands. Clearly, the entire area encompasses in this proposal are identified as Hawaiian Kingdom Crown and Government lands. Further protections are stated in the Admissions Act in numerous sections, including Section 5F regarding the ceded lands belonging to the Hawaiian Kingdom Crown and Government, with clearly stated beneficiaries, which are five, all directed to benefit the Hawaiian people. Other enumerations of protections, including protections against desecration and destruction of sacred sites as well, can also be found in Article 12, Section 7 of the State of Hawaii Constitution. Number two, I am a traditional pre-contact Hawaiian religious practitioner, more specifically that of the Lono training. I can also identify those independent individuals who have similar callings and referred to as kukia imana, or the protectors of the sacred Mauna Kea, especially the lands known as Waokua, otherwise known as the realm of the gods. That the so-called encampments are misidentified as to their functions are staging areas for religious activities and comfort areas for the visiting practitioners, the kupuna, and the youth, in alignment with the first law of Hawaii, Mamalahoa Kanawai, or otherwise known as the law of the splintered paddle. This law is demonstrated in all law enforcement badges, including the emblems of the state and the county in the form of the tea leaf for the cross paddles. Number three, the proposed 1 mile court, 1 mile on either side of the Mauna Kea access road to be considered a restricted zone presents imminent harm to those religious practitioners who many of their practices are at night on the Mauna, as they correlate to certain star features in various times. Obviously, stars can only be seen at night, as the position of those stars change continuously during the night and vary according to the seasons and times. Placing restrictions on such items as backpacks, blankets, tarps, etc., creates an unsafe condition to health and safety of those exercising religious practices both day and night due to the extreme high elevation and often extreme weather, and presents extraordinary liabilities to the state and the University of Hawaii's Office of Mauna Kea Management, as well as personal liabilities for those attempting to enforce laws that are arbitrary and capricious. There's much more to say at the present, much more to say and present as argument, but at this this time does not permit continuing. Number six, I or we reserve the right to contest this proposed action in the immediate, as this implied imminent peril poses as a direct imminent harm to those practicing religious ceremony at this elevation day and night. This, I'm going to leave this part out because Michael's here. I also have personally presented to Kahukumana, which is the advisory, Hawaiian advisory group that advises the Office of Mauna Kea Management, detailed maps showing where certain religious practices and cultural practices are conducted on Mauna Kea, specifically those done within the Science Preserve. Both Stephanie Nagata, the director of the Office of Mauna Kea Management, and Wally Ishibashi, who is the cultural advisor for the Office of Mauna Kea Management, sit on this panel of Kahukumana. So they have personally seen these maps and know what religious things we do here. So my conclusion is that we urge this board to reject or to not approve this proposal of emergency rulemaking as described in agenda item C2. And so I thank you for this time to talk to you folks. My background is I'm the last, one of the last people to be trained by Kuluna Samlona. And so I've always represented the religious side of what we do on the mountain. And I flew down from the Big Island this morning. I didn't arrive here till 9:30, but I was just here this past weekend where I do a vigil at Wahilani Palace and have been doing them for the last 15 years. I'm here January 17th to be with the Queen for the overthrow, and I'm also here at July 4th to protest Independence Day, because we're certainly not independent from the United States. And it was also the date that they chose to declare the Republic of Hawaii. As you know, we've been having quite a struggle on the Mauna Kea, and this agenda item C2, which is heard today, is an attempt by the state to limit our ability to access the mountain for religious practices. But this is all based on the 30-meter telescope. And so I wanted to share with you the submittal that the DLNR submitted to the board. And this is their own piece of paper. So I want to read it to you. This is to the chairpersons and members of the Board of Land and Natural Resources. It says, land board members, subject: a request for approval to adopt a new section under Hawaii Administrative Rules as Title 13, Aloha, Chapter 123, Section 21.2, to restrict the use of and access to portions of the public hunting areas, units A and K, on Mauna Kea, Hawaii Island, through the emergency rulemaking procedures to protect against imminent peril to public safety and natural resources. This rule can be reviewed it can be found at the Hawaii Government Office Administrative Rules, or it can be reviewed. Anyway, I want to get to the meat of this. So the background of this information, it says public hunting area A on the island of Hawaii comprises lands of the Mauna Kea Forest Reserve and Game Management Area, as well as land included in the Mauna Kea Science Reserve, portions of public hunting area Unit K, Mauna Kea Ice Age Reserve, are located in the portions of Unit A and the upper slopes of Mauna Kea. Those public hunting areas contain numerous sensitive natural resources, including indigenous plants and animals and geological features and cultural sites, which are protected under state law. Those public hunting areas are also located in a remote and high elevation, subject to natural hazards and extreme and inclemental weather. Within the past 2 weeks, increasing numbers of persons have established overnight long-term occupancy in portions of those public hunting areas that includes the establishment of structures and facilities, including tents and encampments and other shelters, portable restroom facilities, and various amenities. This long-term residency of such person currently poses a risk to public safety by establishing a presence of persons in those very remote areas where they may expose themselves and others to hazardous conditions and severe weather. Numerous law enforcement actions have taken place in recent days, placing staff, officers, and the public at risk. The presence of such persons is also resulting in the impact to natural resources through their trampling and other direct impacts, as well as the accumulation of waste, litter, and other disposables. The consultation with law enforcement and other appropriate entities indicated that the detrimental impacts occurring as a result of this situation are likely to continue, and current administrative rules do not provide immediate and effective means of addressing the threats posed by the activities to public safety and natural resources. They claim their authority as the Department of Land and Natural Resources has been delegated the power and duty to manage and regulate all lands which may be set apart as game management area, public hunting areas, and wildlife sanctuaries. To carry out these duties, the department has authorized to promulgate rules concerning the preservation and protection and regulation of extensive and utilization and conditions of entry into wildlife sanctuaries, game management areas, and public hunting areas designated by the department. Anyway, I'm going to stop right here because there's a gentleman here that I think you need to hear from because he is directly addressing this. Do you mind, Mr. Chang? Would you? Well, okay. By the way, who I was just speaking to is Professor Williamson Chang from the Richardson School of Law, who's also here to testify. So I just wanted to include what the purposes of this thing was. In the purpose section of it, it says the Department of Forestry and Wildlife proposes to adopt emergency rules prohibiting the possession and the use of the following items: backpacks, tents, blankets, tarpaulins, and other obvious camping paraphernalia, and entry into and remaining in the portions of the public hunting areas, Unit A and K, Hawaii Island, from 8 p.m. to 5 a.m. For portions of the public hunting area within a 1 mile of Mauna Kea Observation Road, indicated in Exhibit A and referred to here as the restricted area. The division is proposing these rules to address the impacts of natural resources that are occurring in those units due to the presence of permanent encampments and their associated structures, facilities, activities, and impacts, as well as to eliminate the risks posed to public safety that may be from the presence of numerous individuals that remain in those areas after dark, or they may place themselves and others at risk due to the remote nature of the areas and possible impacts from hazardous condition and inclement weather. The vision recognizes that certain numbers of the public wish to access the subject public hunting areas and does not intend to impede such activities if conducted in a safe manner that does not jeopardize the public safety and those resources. So they're proposing to be able to close off the mountain from 8 to 5. And so what I had talked to you about earlier is that this is all illegal. This is all illegal. And who is best to speak of this, if I may ask you to?
Here's your contested case request.
Okay.
This man filed a contested case request, and I filed it already, and he's going to file it again when I speak. And maybe you can just read from why you're objecting right here on 21.
Okay, this is page 21 of the contested case.
Number 21.
And so under this item 21 in the contested case form, it says any disagreement petitioner may have with the application before the judge. And so our answer is the proposed rules is defective because, one, DLNR lacks territorial jurisdiction. Number two, the rule is an unlawful infringement on the First Amendment rights of assembly, free speech, and the free exercise of religion. Number three, under Hawaii Revised Statutes 183D-2, the DLNR lacks statutory authority to regulate camping and access as to the concerns stated in the staff submittal, and that the proposed rules is not rationally related to the objectives assigned to the DLNR under Hawaii law. And so, Mr. Chang, would you like to read your addendum?
Say a few words.
Yes, if you can. By the way, this is Professor Williamson Chang from the University of Hawaii Richardson School of Law.
I'm here as the attorney and counsel for two people who are filing a contested case request, and that's Hanalei Fergustrom here, and my client on the Big Island, whom I'm representing in his criminal defense proceeding against the arrest, Kali'i Ione. Okay, wait, they're calling us.
Okay, I'm like, okay, hello, my everybody. We're going to be called in, so.
24 seats plus one testifier seat in front of the room. So please, I'm sorry, at the back of the room, so please fill the seats that are marked testifiers. The front seats are reserved for staff, the Attorney General's office, some UH people, and a few media seats as well.
Mama kakaua, Hawaiian.
Hawaiian.
Williamson Chang.
Good afternoon, board. My name is Williamson Chang. I'm a professor of law at the University of Hawaii and have been for 39 years as the longest serving member of the faculty. I am here as the counsel for Mr. Hanalei Fergustrom and Mr. Keke who are filing a request for a contested case hearing. And that was filed at 7 o'clock this morning. But now I realize the rule has changed. So I'd like to take care of that by filing a new request. And I don't have much time up here. If you want to know what I'm going to argue, you can read the testimony I have filed, and I have extra copies here if you haven't seen it. They're available here. And I have copies for all of those who are outside as well. I always try to bring them. First, I want to say that in filing the contested case hearing, it occurred to me that what's not going to happen, which usually happens, is there's going to be a stay on the administrative action. There's no question that the trucks that are building the PMP are going to continue up under this rule. This rule is a pretty thinly disguised effort to facilitate what the governor said. Essentially, the PMP is going to be built. And that bothers me. I don't think that the 120 days of truce and negotiation can take place in such an environment. And if this board either doesn't grant the contested case hearing or doesn't stay the effectiveness of the rule, essentially I'm going to be forced to move to court to enjoin and declare the actions of this board in adopting C1 and C2 to be unconstitutional, beyond your powers under state law, beyond your powers in Section 183D, and I know you had an hour with the Attorney General. I'm going to be across from him. I only have 32 seconds left. So if you want to ask me what my strategy is, I'd be happy to answer that. But first, let me say, I'm probably going to have to name you as individual defendants in your individual capacity. That's just required by law, and it's nothing personal. I am admirers of all of you, and I respect you, but this will be decided in the courts. Thank you.
Thank you.
I've got a couple of questions.
Okay.
Professor Chang, you wrote an article in Civil Beat where you said a number of things, but one of them was that President Obama could stop the construction on Mauna Kea by invoking the Antiquities Act and declaring it a national monument. That's completely wrong, you know.
It is wrong. I apologize. What I meant was you could start a process by which eventually it could reach the status of a World Heritage Site, which was a pretty fast track for Papahānau Makea, and then perhaps we could stop it. In other words, I was really just saying one thing, which is we have a local boy as president, and this is a really important issue to the state in which he was born, and he ought to weigh in some way. Either mediate or do what he thinks is best. And I think it's funny that Mauna Kea is simply a conservation district area, whereas Mauna Loa and Kilauea are on the World Heritage Site, and Papahānau Makea is a World Heritage Site, and they're They're married together.
You basically, I had this question about the legality of using the Antiquities Act, and you answered that question. I also have a question. Basically, you provide us a 30 or 40 page legal brief, which I take it as arguing that the United States government has no authority.
No, I argue that DLNR has
no authority. Because the United States government had no authority?
No, because if you look in the state constitution, the territorial boundaries define what's in the state as all the islands that are acquired by the joint resolution.
Yes.
And do you believe, sir, that a joint resolution of Congress of the United States could acquire a foreign sovereign independent country?
I'm not here to debate that point. I just...
Well, that's the definition of the territorial
The question I was going to ask you is, do you think there is federal authority, U.S. federal authority over Hawaii?
Yes, they're clearly here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Gravel has significant drop-offs on the side.
Wait a second. Aloha, Michael. Aloha. Aloha, Andre Perez. No koloa koa imayo. Just want to point out, there's a problem going on even with this meeting. We're all getting parking tickets out there. So if we come off the mountain, the struggle and the things that we have to endure, we have to come to this meeting and get a $40 parking ticket. I'm not the only one. Many people are getting tickets out there. And your parking attendant is standing by outside waiting to ticket people as the time expires. So I think that's a problem that you guys should address. Also, I want to point out that in addition to all this Hawaiian suppression that's going on the mountain, we also have OEV TV who's been barred from this meeting, but there's other media going on right now that's filming this inside this room. So I don't think that's fair to OEV TV, a Hawaiian-owned media business. Yeah. Okay, I absolutely oppose the rulemaking. I want that to stand for the record. When the United States invaded and bombed Iraq, one of the first things they did was they targeted sanitation facilities. They bombed the water facilities. And in principle, that's what's happening on the mountain in response to Hawaiians protecting the mountain right now. They shut off the water. They've locked the sanitation facilities. And so they're trying to starve us off the mountain. Yeah? There can be no doubt that these actions and rules are designed to purposefully suppress and marginalize Kanaka Maoli, criminalize us, and starve us off our own mountain. I believe that these are fundamentally human rights issues and self-determination issues. Are Hawaiians human beings? Do we have the right to say we don't want this on our land? Is this Hawaiian land? Does anybody question that? Does anybody think this is not Hawaiian land, that we don't have kuleana to this land as Aboriginal people? I believe we have a clear human rights self-determination issue going on right now, and I see how, in principle, fundamentally, we're being targeted as hazards and health issues to public safety. I think it's a very bad move on the state, and the Hawaiian community would not forgive and forget this for a very long time. There's no question that we have an issue, ongoing, long-standing issue of redress and reconciliation between Kanaka Maoli and the United States, State of Hawaii, as outlined in the apology bill. So we have to have sensitivity to that as well. We believe that these types of rules, desecration, will result in harm to the deeply held religious beliefs and cultural values of Hawaiian people. And as a result of this failure of the administration process, because we know it's still in court right now. You all know that. Still in court right now. Yet they're still trying to build the TMT while the issue is still in court. As a result of the failure of this administration process, we believe that further desecration is imminent. And we're compelled to occupy and to protect Mauna Kea as a people, as human beings who love and have a strong relationship with our land. Desecration of Mauna Kea and suppression of Hawaiians on the mountain will be a moral outrage to Hawaiians and to the greater community. In closing, I just want to say that civil disobedience is based on moral political principle. America is a country that's founded on civil disobedience. From the Boston Tea Party, anti-war movements, women's suffrage, abolition of slavery, labor laws and unions, civil rights movements, anti-nuclear war movements, environmental and forest protection movements are all part of civil disobedience. And if these rules are passed, there can be no question there will be mass coordinated civil disobedience on Mauna Kea to break these rules based on moral and political principle. I think it would be a disaster to pass these rules. It will only exacerbate the situation. Hawaiian community
can you wrap it up, please?
Has welcomed settlers with nothing but aloha to even our own detriment. We're not hazardous or dangerous to the community or to our land. Mahalo.
Thank you.
Aloha mai kakou. My name is Candace Fujikane. I'm an English professor at the University of Hawaii, and I'm here to oppose agenda items C1 and C2. Regarding C1, if the chairperson of the DLNR is granted executive power to close public hunting areas, there will be no public oversight or input in making important decisions about what constitutes public safety or protection of natural resources. Regarding C2, neither acting administrator of the Division of Forestry and Wildlife, Scott Fretz, nor Attorney General Douglas Chin has identified imminent peril or threats to public safety that can be specifically attributed to camping. Fretz's call for emergency rulemaking for the public hunting area is unwarranted given that hunters and cultural practitioners have been camping on those lands for years. Chin's concerns about the boulders and rock walls placed on the road cannot be attributed to camping. Attributing the introduction of invasive species to the protectors is also disingenuous given the traffic of 300,000 visitors to the mountain every year. The placing of unauthorized toilets is not an imminent peril, nor is the consumption of water. Stephanie Nagasa, director of the OMKM, has described the protectors as cordial. Clearly, this proposal is another effort to remove the protectors from the mountain so that the TMT can proceed with construction. The public is concerned about transparency and accountability. The decisions about the protection of natural resources cannot be left to one person, as the problematic reasoning by both Fretz and Chin illustrate. I'm concerned about how these emergency rulemaking processes will impact the ability of Uiwi to engage in cultural practices. I am not Hawaiian, but as a member of Huaka'i'ina Aina Mauna, I have walked with Kukawakahi on the ancient Kuamo'o, some of which fall within the proposed restricted areas. Who engages in walking the trails, the practice of ka'opuni ma ka'ika'i, traveling on spiritual huaka'i or journeys taken as occasions to view, remember, and teach the mo'olelo, the histories and the stories of the wahipano or celebrated places of Mauna Wakea. These huaka'i span not one day, but several days. This cultural practice is also critically important to the monitoring of sacred sites, as we have seen desecration happening on remote parts of the Mauna. Water from the sacred springs, Kahopokane and Waihu, have been recently diverted through aluminum pipes down the Mauna to storage tanks near Pohakuloa. Who authorized this diversion? Why wasn't the general public notified and allowed to provide input? We need public oversight in order to protect Mauna Wakea. And I have photographs, before and after photographs, of what the springs looked like in 2005 and what they looked like last year. We have looked out over Na'aina Mauna, the mountain lands, and we have seen the land as the late afternoon sun cast a yellow glow on the grassy slopes. I think of Poli'ahu and her sisters Lilinoe Waiau and Kahopokane, and the golden pa'u made from the kapa pounded from the rays of the sun. I think of Waiau and Mo'inanea, the reptilian water deity who is kahu, or guardian to Poli'ahu, as she dwells in Waiau during the summer months. From a vantage point on an ancient Kuamo'o in the proposed restricted area, we have seen what kupuna of long ago would have seen, clouds rolling in around the pu'u that evoke Kane, Huna, Moku, and the other 12 islands of Kane, floating high among the clouds. In Keao Mele Mele, Moses Manu references three of the islands, Kuaihilani, Keolohilani, and Nu'umealani, as once being home to Mo'ainanea.
Can you wrap it up now?
Just a little bit more. All of these sites inspire the remembering of these mo'olelo manomakea. How many o'iwi will miss these experiences if emergency rules are implemented without cause? I urge you to oppose this proposal for the emergency rule. Nakia imauna are only doing what you yourselves have sworn to do as members of the PLNR to protect the conservation district and the sacred lands of Mauna Wakea. Thank you.
Thank you.
You want to see the pictures? I have the pictures right here. They were amazingly beautiful. The springs were green. There was a carpet of grass. Who wanted to sleep on the grass when we went hiking last year? But instead of this, what we actually saw was barbed wire around concrete poured to create these reservoirs and aluminum pipes, drawing water from these very sacred springs that are recorded in the mo'olelo of Kamiki, who went to Waiau to get water to make awa, and some of the water jiggled out and created these springs that spread across Pohakuloa all the way to Hualalai.
So did you follow where the pipes go to?
Yeah, you can see it on Google Earth. You can see the silver line of the pipe. They go down to these four water tanks that are down by Pohakuloa. So anybody can look that up on Google Earth. And we don't know who approved that diversion or where the water is going, what it's being used for. We're just hoping it's not being used for toilets in the state parks. We have no idea what the water is being used for.
But what's the name of the spring?
The springs are Kahopo'okane and Waihu. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, number 43, Alfred.
Aloha Kaku. My name is Baron Chang. I'm going to be fast with this. I have to be fast. I'll have to go over. Okay, I wear a lot of hats. One hat I want to wear is safety and medical officer for Huka'ia Mauna Kea. If you don't know who we are, there have been several of us who have been here already. We walk the trails of Mauna Kea starting from 2002. And if you don't know who we are the guys in 2013 who found Mr. Brian Murphy, the guy who was lost from Michigan for 5 years in the mountain. We go where other people don't. And can I explain what happened when we did that? We had to call the cops. We had to call DNR, don't care. We had to call the Mauna Kea Rangers. We were delayed, okay? This was a day after Hurricane Flossie. Okay, we did not make it to the pickup point in time. We had to spend overnight on the mountain with 40 mile an hour winds at the peak. And it was cold. Okay, we deployed emergency blankets. We had emergency food. We had emergency water. Now, the new rules say no tarps, no backpacks. Like, well, we would have been in really bad shape if we didn't have this stuff. Okay? The other thing, okay, these trails take a long time to walk over. If we're going to start access at 1 p.m., you're not going to get off the mountain in time. And if you're not going to have your survival blankets and your water and your supplies, you're talking about potential mortal danger here. You're not making the place any safer. So I stand opposed to all of this. The other hat I wear, okay, I'm Vice Chair Ahahui Malama of Kaniakapupu. We are the stewards of Kaniakapupu, and you can see our agreement with DLNR. We've been there since 2002. It was clearly stated to us that we do not have police policy. Okay, if we tell people not to do stuff over there, we do it on the basis of moral authority. If somebody does something up there that they're not supposed to be doing, we call Dokir. We call the cops. The guys on Mauna Kea Rangers, some of the stuff they've been doing is atrocious. If we did that kind of stuff, there'd be complaints about us. You guys would be pulling this stewardship agreement like this fast. And the other thing, we'd probably get arrested for assault. I don't think you should let the Mauna Kea Rangers run that place.
And incidentally, I know what happened to the waters of Hopokani. What happened was in 2005 when we went there, it was already partially diverted. The military was taking it to run their air station at Pohakuloa. We went there again in 2014, and it was completely diverted, 100%, all channeled into a concrete basin. All that was transferred to DLNR, Department of Parks. Every single drop was diverted down to Pohakuloa State Park. And these are the waters of Kane. This is the waters of life. The water is not being processed, okay? It's not potable. All that stuff is being used is to flush toilets and to wash your hands. This is the waters of Kane, the waters of life. This comes from the springs of Hopokani, one of the four sister goddesses of Mauna Kea, the physical embodiment. All right, one more thing, if I may. Okay, you know, the Mauna Kea guys, you know, they say that, oh, you know, they got this white cloak, you know, they're science, they're pure. Well, the fact of the matter is they are not quite that pure. You know, we have records of what abuses can occur in science. You all know of the 1932 Tuskegee experiment where they took Afro-American minorities with syphilis and they didn't treat them, they let them die. They produced wonderful science, advanced mankind, you know? They published papers, they had academic advancement.
Time for you to wrap up.
Pardon?
Please wrap up.
Okay. They have not done any kind of ethical study on this. In medicine, we have, okay, I'm an assistant clinical professor of medicine at John A. Burns School of Medicine. We do, whenever we do anything, we have to institution review committee. We have to look to see what adverse effects our study is doing. And we don't do it if the committee says that you are adversely affecting a group. The astronomers have never done that. They've never had done an ethical review. And we have more than enough instances where science has failed on the ethical side. You know, the nuclear bombs in Micronesia, I mean, that's a complete ethical failure. I think the telescope guys really need to do a multidisciplinary ethical review of what they're doing.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Great. Number 80 is Rachel Harbottle.
Aloha mai. My name is Nabore Villa, and I'm here humbly before you to read testimony on behalf of Clarence Kumukauoha, Ms. Chair and members of the Board of Land and Natural Resources. I am Clarence Kuching, age 79, a longtime Hawaiian cultural and religious practitioner on Mauna Kea. I am also a longtime student and practitioner of the Lua. Okay. Being a member.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but if you're not going to have time to read the whole thing, so
oh, no,
you
I'm
want
not-
to summarize.
Yes.
Okay.
I know. Thank you. Being a member of Pākuia Lua. I am in opposition to the adoption of the proposed rule. The proposed emergency rulemaking does not meet the requirements to be legally adopted at this time. The basis that should be required to justify the passage of a rule should be credible. The basis upon which you rely for adoption are skewed in incredible and illogical ways that you should be ashamed to even start to consider enacting the proposed rule. At this time, whether it is timely or not, this testifier requests contested case hearing. An important part of my practice includes walking, hiking, across, up and down the aina, walking, hiking in the footsteps of our ancestors. I am a co-founder and leader of Huaka'i na Aina Mauna. In 2002, we started hiking at sea level at Koholalele Landing at Kukai'au on the Hamakua coast, and proceeded up the Umikoa and Kaula trails to the summit of Mauna Kea, then went down the Skyline Trail, crossed Pohakuloa Training Area, down the old Kona Road to the Pu'uana Hulu, then down Pu'uana Hulu Kiholo Trail, ending at sea level on Kiholo Bay at Luahine Bay, where we were privileged to swim in that most famous pond. In 2003, we walked, hiked from the summit of Mauna Kea to the rim of Mokua Veo Veo on Mauna Loa, then down and around Kilauea, then down the Ke'alho Trail to Ke'alho Landing at sea level. Huaka'i'ina Aina Mauna is planning our activities that will take place later on this month. Near the end of the month, we are walking, hiking from the Mauna Kea Access Road at Pu'ulilinoi at about 13,000 feet, to Pu'u Makanaka on the Kaula Trail, then descending to about 10,000 feet. We will be starting at approximately 8 a.m. That will give us the full day needed to accomplish our objectives. You are on notice by my testimony here that this activity is taking place. While you say that a permit is required, I disagree, as permission is not required when one has a right to exercise. We will be exercising our constitutionally provided cultural and religious rights. On July 31st, we will be flying our nation's flag on the summit of on the summit at noon with appropriate oli and hule to celebrate Kalahoʻihoʻiʻea. These two activities may be curtailed, I believe, if the subject rule that is being addressed today is promulgated, and that will make us very unhappy. Let me tell you, I will not accept $1 million to not be able to participate in these activities. I will not sell my right to practice. Therefore, I would suggest that you curtail all further action on the emergency rulemaking and the irregular, illegal, and unconstitutional curtailing of my and my fellow Kanaka Maoli rights to practice our customary and traditional cultural and religious rights. Mahalo nui. Thank you.
Will you please remind Mr. Ching that he needs to follow up with a written contested case hearing request within 10 days? Okay, so we have number 70, Kaui Oni.
Thank you very much, and if you all want to take a break, I won't be offended. Okay. Again, my name is Mari Townsend. I'm the director for the Sierra Club of Hawaii. I've been involved in the effort to protect Mauna Kea for many, many years in various organizations and various capacities. Much of my testimony covers things that have already been said, but the third and fourth points, I think, are important to raise. Part of why I'm concerned about these temporary rules is because I know that the Office of Mauna Kea Management is currently considering their own restrictions to public access. And they're frightening, you know. They definitely favor astronomers over everyone else. They would prohibit people using flashlights, for example, and cell phones on the mountain. They would authorize the chancellor to restrict access for up to 2 years at a time. And we're concerned that these temporary rules will be used somehow in this OMKM process, which is not rulemaking, because they are convinced they do not have to follow rulemaking. And that's a problem. But I also want to address litigation. I mean, Mr. Ewan and Mr. Roig seem to think that it's easy for members of the public to conduct litigation. It's extremely difficult. I've been involved in this for a very long time, not as long as many, but I have seen the toll that it takes. And just getting an injunction is cost prohibitive. You have to put up a bond, for example. And the thing is that you wonder, what can you as a government do? And I actually have a suggestion. If you as the government could say, pause the TMT CDUP until the Supreme Court issues its ruling, you have a temporary reprieve and a time in which you can negotiate and work out with opposing sides a compromise. And in that temporary reprieve, all access up the road could be allowed because the protectors will feel no reason to guard the road and to prevent access to the other telescopes. There is no controversy with the current telescopes up there. There's nothing wrong with people going, you know, the protectors have nothing against that. It's just the construction equipment for the 30-meter telescope. When they read the rules, and in the plain reading of the rule, it says you can't have a substantial adverse impact. And the EIS says the TMT has a substantial adverse impact. And yet you allowed it to happen. It's hard for them to believe in a rule of law. And I just have to say, when you look at these temporary rules, C1 and C2, that would bar public access, I'd like you to take a moment, step back, and imagine, instead of a telescope being built on a distant mountain, actually the controversy at the heart here would be a luxury subdivision on a shoreline or a federal highway over a reef. And instead of native Hawaiians standing in front of you with kiwis and backpacks, you'd have surfers their long hair and their surfboards. And would you seriously consider barring public access to the shoreline to surfers and other ocean users in order to make the luxury home developer feel more comfortable and then just tear up the shoreline while there's litigation going on? I don't think that you would. And so I'm urging you here today to not do that in this case. Instead, tell the TMT to hold its horses until the Supreme Court issues its ruling. Thank you.
Thank you.
How do you feel about what's going on here today?
Well, obviously, I think disagreement with the proposed rule change, but not opposed to what's happening today. All of these kind of things, they help us. It keeps people engaged. It keeps people active, and it gives people an opportunity to get active and get engaged if they haven't already, in a way that's perhaps not so intimidating, for lack of a better word, as getting engaged on the mountain in the time of resistance. So I think this is to our advantage. It allows our people to come together again and showcase our strength, our knowledge, our unity, and our commitment. And again, the vast majority, if 90 to 95%, maybe even more, are in opposition to the proposed rule change, because we understand that this change is directly targeting the Kūkiaʻi Mauna protectors on Mauna Wakea and trying to get them off the mountain, trying to make their efforts, or our efforts to protect the mountain, more difficult than it already is, and really to assist TMT in getting up the mountain to desecrate it. So it's good for the people. It's yet to be seen if they'll listen to the people this time, but if the people do have any say, any impact on the decision that should be made, then we should know what the decision is, and that's to oppose this proposed rule change.
So they're trying to kind of, I think, expand the, you could call it a field of battle.
Uh-huh.
Even bigger stakes to distract, to bring it onto their ground. And I noticed TMT and, this whole consortium, they're trying to box people into stereotypical boxes so it can be sold to, their investors and sold all over the world so that they've got you contained.
Mm-hmm.
But I noticed people in this movement are really trying to be themselves and look at the bigger picture and not be contained, and that's the beauty of it.
Yeah. You can't contain this movement to say it's strictly political, it's strictly cultural, it's strictly spiritual, it's strictly religious, it's strictly environmental. It's all of those things. And we have people coming from all kind of different backgrounds. Because again, like we've been saying from the very beginning, we are not an official group. We're not an organization. We're simply individuals who have come together to work together because we have the same goal in mind. And that's to protect Mauna Wakea. Now, everybody may have different reasons, or we may share similar reasons and then have different reasons from others. And I think that's the beauty of it, is that we're able to cover a bunch of different aspects. You cannot box us in and say, this is a group of, religious people. This is a group of political activists. This is a group of Kanaka, of Hawaiians, non-Hawaiians, people of Hawaii, people of the world who understand the crucial need to truly preserve and protect our natural resources. And again, to protect our rights as a people, and to protect our sacred places, places that we know are sacred, regardless of who wants to recognize it or not. We know as a people, it's sacred. And so we protect those things. So again, they can't box us in. We're coming from all kind of different angles, we're coming from different perspectives, but all with one goal, protect Mauna Wakea.
I remember Socrates used to say that he liked debating with people who lived their philosophy. He didn't just like people who just debated to win and just to perfect the argument.
Mm-hmm.
So, in a way, you guys are living your philosophy and being like true philosophers, as you would say. So that's why they listen to you.
Yeah.
Because you're actually living your philosophy.
And it's an education opportunity. We're more than willing, more than happy to engage in a friendly debate, in a productive debate, assuming that both sides can come with an open mind, open the ao, and listen, and truly try to understand where the other side is coming from. And for me, I understand where they're coming from. They love their science. They want to practice their research. Mauna Kea is the most ideal place in the world for them to do that. It doesn't make it the right place. So what we need to get them to understand is where we're coming from. Because again, I can acknowledge them. I can acknowledge what they're trying to do. Right on. They just chose, as my t-shirt would say, the wrong place, wrong time, wrong people. But they can't seem to comprehend where we're coming from. And so, but it doesn't mean we're going to give up. You know, even Gandhi, in all of the struggles, he still continued dialogue and communication with the opposition. And people would give him flack for it. And he said, one day I'm going to convince them. And that's, you know, we're going to try. We're going to convince them. And if we're not going to convince them, then we're going to beat them.
And I was going to ask, back to the science question. I mean, Hawaiian science, as one of my friends once said to me, it's links of logic that prove reason. And basically, it's just like science, but it doesn't have the same dichotomies of nature being separate from humanity, mm-hmm. nature being separate from society. Hawaiian science may have dichotomies, but not similar to that. People try to include everything. And I was talking to Mike Lee earlier about Pono and truth. It's based mm-hmm. on that. And then it tries to make it whole. But the dichotomy is in Western science. They've forgotten, I guess, that root mm-hmm. that even they have before with their science.
Yeah. Well, then, you know, they keep saying, you know, the science and the culture can coexist. It can coexist. It's really, when it comes to us, it's not an attempt to science was our culture. It was really the foundation of our culture. The ability, our culture was formed when we got here to Hawaii. And how did we get here to Hawaii? Through science, through astronomy, through the understanding of the swells and the winds and the tides and the rising of the sun, the setting of the and the rising of the moon and the stars and their patterns. I mean, the ability to build a canoe out of wood and stone and sailed across the greatest ocean in the world in a time where most people thought the world was flat and or couldn't swim. I mean, that's science, you know? The lo'i, the lo'hui'a, the hales we built, the structures, the civilization, that's all scientific. It's just not their kind of science. You know, I mean, and we didn't need to utilize the tools that they utilize for that science, and we did not need to desecrate land. Our sciences really were not only something that would preserve life, but really that could create life. The va'a. It brought us here, and we created a new life here, a new civilization. You know, the lo'i, the loko'i'a, that sustained life. It fed the people. So science and culture, that whole coexisting thing, I mean, science is our culture. Culture is our science. It's basically one and the same, I think. So again, they're just coming from a different perspective. They can't understand, they can't grasp, they can't comprehend where we come from, where we are, and where we need to go. They can only see, they only want to see 13 billion years away, you know, to the beginning of time. And nothing wrong with that. But don't destroy what we have now to go back in time and see what was there before. You know, take care of this place. Yeah, like Hawaiian Forest, yeah, before you look into space, malama this place. And that's something that they failed miserably to do, whether that be the state, the DLNR, the University of Hawaii, and TMT. Regardless of all of these efforts, so-called efforts that they've made to better their relationship, it's like, you know, giving someone candy before you beat them up. Does it make beating them up any less bad? No. It's still an issue. It's still wrong, and they're still trying to desecrate the mountain. So, scientific perspectives, again, just we can understand where they're coming from. I don't think they can understand where we're coming from.
And also, it's any culture, even Hawaiian culture, could be influenced by kala and money system, which makes a relationship with you real simplistic and deals on a kind of narrow spectrum, while other kind of relationships like bartering influence like relationships.
Uh-huh.
And it deals with a lot more. So sometimes people just get distracted by kala
mm-hmm.
and by power.
Yeah.
And so I see that with this TMT, people are getting big time distracted, big mm-hmm. eyes with the big 1.4. It kind of blinds them to really the other relationships that are being
yeah.
shortcut.
And that's something that, again, has been instilled within us from the time of our kupuna, from 1893, after the illegal overthrow of the government, you know. Walava mako ikapo haku. O ale mako e mina mina ikapo uka lao keo puni. Walava mako ikapo haku ika ai kamaha o ka aina. Yeah, we care not. We couldn't care less about the money. What we care about, what we're satisfied with, is the stones, the land that which feeds us. And that, I think that mindset is still persisting today, and maybe stronger, maybe not than ever before, but stronger than a long time. And again, we come from a generation that has been provided Hawaiian language education, Hawaiian culture education, and even the ability to continue on to higher levels of education and get a degree in Hawaiian language or Hawaiian studies. And so we understand these things, and we know the words of our kupuna to be true. You know, Papa Mau, Piailu, before he took Hokula'a to Kaiki, he said, you know, if I have courage, it's because I have remembered the teachings of my ancestors. And that's what gives us the courage to do what we're doing today, to continue to what we're going to do, you know, tomorrow and next week and next month and next year, is the teachings of our ancestors. We've been taught those things. We've remembered those things. We're going to act upon those things. Money, never eaten money in my life. Never have. But I have eaten from this land. I will continue to eat from this land. And money will never replace that, no matter how many dollar bills they want to throw in our face.
And being there upon Manawa Kea is an expression of your nature and of greater nature.
Mm-hmm.
So you're there expressing who you are.
Exactly.
In all these times, from October 7th till March, yeah, and now June 24th, the last time they came.
We're being who we are, we're being who we need to be. You know, we live in a system that really tries to make us something that we're not, and something that we really cannot be. We are who we are, we cannot change it. You know, mo'okuauhau is mo'okuauhau. No matter what you say, no matter what you do, cannot change that. And we're up there expressing what I believe to be aloha aina o ia i'o. A true, not just a true love for the land, but a true patriotic love for the land. Understanding the relationship we have to the land. It's genealogical, and then in this new day and age, ever since 1843, there's a political relationship to it as well, and a nationalistic relationship to it, and understanding that Mauna Kea, sitting in the Ahupua of Ka'ohe in the Moku of Hamakua, government lands designated by the Hawaiian Kingdom, 1848, never ceded to America. Seized, never ceded. So when you understand that too, then you have another responsibility, and that's to protect national lands. But I mean, it's all of it. It's not one or the other. It's to protect the national lands, to protect the mountain that which we know to be sacred, a mountain that we know shares the same genealogy, or we share the same genealogy as that mountain. So it's aloha aina, oia i'o, truth. You know, we know the truth, and the truth is so powerful that it will force you, in a sense, it'll empower you to do what needs to be done, and it'll set our people free.
And I was going to ask you, would you like to say anything on what has happened recently, like on the 24th or any of the days?
I think the 24th, I think June 24th was a beautiful day. It was another victory for the people of Hawaii. Not just Hawaiians, but all people of Hawaii. You know, if we truly love Hawaii, we love Hawaii for what it is, not what we want it to be. You know, we love Hawaii for what it should be. And Mauna Kea exemplifies that, I think. You know, it's a, you have the telescopes up there, but when you're up there, you can feel connected. You can feel senses what it used to be like here in Hawaii, in other areas, the calm, the quiet, you know, the stillness and all of that. But it was beautiful because there was no public call made. TMT came out with a statement on a Saturday saying they're going to resume construction on Wednesday, and by 5 o'clock Tuesday, there was hundreds of people on the mountain, and there was hundreds the next morning. And we came together as a people without any designated leadership, without any, you know, true organization and preparation. What we had was aloha aina oia i'o, and it brought us together, and we understood that we were there for a cause that is much, much greater than any one individual or any group of individuals. It's greater than us. And so I think it's a testament to the activation that we're seeing, the mobilization we're seeing, the unification that we're seeing of our people, which I think we're in the greatest activation, mobilization, and unification of Hawaiian people since 1897. And that was a testament, that was a showing of that. And we did it. You know, we stopped another day of a $1.4 billion project. And after June 24th, when I look at the make-believe scoreboard hanging on the wall, I see Kukia'i Mauna 3 and TMT 0. And so we have no reason to believe that we cannot be victorious, because every experience that we've had up to this point shows us that we can be and we will be.
And all these different things are expressions of people all over the world. It is just of a continuum that's gone from long ago.
Mm-hmm. And so we're here, you know, and we quote and we look back to our ancestors, but we can also look around the world and see that we're not the only ones struggling. We've been visited by Native peoples from all over America, even other places of the world, who not only understand what we're going through, but are experiencing the same things. They're going through the same exact struggle. It's just a different people in a different place. So it's not just the Hawaii movement. This is something that, again, people around the world can understand and are experiencing themselves. And they truly support what we're doing. And we'd like for them to know that we truly support what they're doing. And let us all be victorious in the end. Let the land be victorious. That's what it's about. It's about aloha aina and he ali'ika aina, he kaua ke kanaka. The land is a chief, the people is a servant. Let's bring that mana'o back to life and make it true again. And let's start here in Hawaii.
Mahalo, Oahu.
Mahalo nui. Appreciate it. Mahalo.